Hey everyone, a very good morning. So after a long time back, I have brought to you the Morning Tales video. In this video, we will be covering about the recently announced national monetization pipeline. We will also be discussing the newly released Global Manufacturing Risk Index. Apart from this, a new operation, Operation Devi Shakti, has also been launched by the Indian government. We will be discussing all these questions in this video, and also remember that this is not all. I will be having more questions in this session. So let's begin this session, and you have to stick to this session till the end of this video. So on that note, myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs, and guys, this is the Morning Tales video, which is relevant for your RBI SEBI NABARD phase 1 GK examination. Okay. So let's begin. But before that, you have to subscribe and hit the bell notification, because this is going to help you in getting the notification of our new videos. This is the Telegram group. The PDF of this session will be provided to you on this Telegram group only. The link of this Telegram group is in description below, from where you can join it. So here is the first question about the national monetization pipeline. So how much does India want to achieve in FY22 through the national monetization pipeline? First of all, the very first thing that you need to know about this national monetization pipeline is that the total corpus, the total amount that the government of India is aiming to achieve through this national monetization pipeline is rupees 6 lakh crores. Or 6 trillion, or you can say US dollar 81 billion. So all these amounts are equal. Okay. So this is the target through this national monetization pipeline. What is this all about? That we will be discussing. But first, you need to understand the total corpus. And out of this 6 lakh crore that the government aims to achieve by the year FY25, 88,000 crores will be achieved in 2021 to 2022. That is the ongoing year, of which 5 months have already been passed. So in the remaining 7 months, the government is aiming to monetize its assets and achieve 88,000 crores. Okay, so the right answer is this. Now let's discuss this pipeline in detail. Before moving on to these points, I want to clarify two main points here. The first thing that you need to know is that monetization and privatization are two different things. Okay. So there are a lot of news articles that are claiming that the government is privatizing the assets. The India is on sale. You must have heard about this statement, India on sale, by Rahul Gandhi. So this is not privatization. Monetization means to monetize the asset. That is, in simple terms, leasing out your assets on a long term basis. So monetization is leasing out the asset on a long term basis. This means that the ownership will remain with the government, it will be transferred to the government, and public interest will be maintained. Okay, so if a road has been given on a lease to a private company, this does not mean that the private company can exploit the owners of the vehicles that are plying on that road. They cannot charge you the exorbitant taxes, toll taxes on the road, because the government is keeping an eye on you. It is just allowing you to earn a revenue which can be a bit higher than what the government was charging, but it could not be and cannot be in any situation higher than a certain level that amounts to exploitation of the consumers. Okay, so it will remain in the public interest because the ownership will be with the government. Thus the burden of compliance, law compliance, will be there. Whereas in privatization, the ownership is transferred from the government to the private entities. In monetization, the private entity is bound to return that asset to the government after the expiry of the lease period. But there is no lease period and no obligation on the private entity to transfer back the asset that it has purchased from the government to the government. Okay, so that is the difference here. The next point is that national monetization pipeline will work together with the national infrastructure pipeline. However, these two are different initiatives. Under this national monetization pipeline, the government is monetizing its existing assets, whereas in national infrastructure pipeline, the government is going to create new assets. Okay. However, the difference here is, or we can say the similarity or the connection here is that these two work hand in hand. How? Basically, under this national monetization pipeline, the government will monetize its assets. Then the money that the government will collect after monetizing the asset will be used to create new infrastructure under this national infrastructure pipeline. So this is going to be a circle. Through the national monetization pipeline, the money will be collected and that money will be used to create new infrastructure under the NIP. Then this new infrastructure will also be given on the lease under this national monetization plan. Then the money will be created, money will be gathered, and through that money, new infrastructure will be created. Then that new infrastructure will also be given on lease through this national monetization plan pipeline. Okay, so this is how these two pipelines or these two plans are interconnected, but these two are different. Okay, so now I'm going to ask a question from you, and that question is a very simple, simplest of all. How much is the corpus of this national infrastructure pipeline? This is your task. Bahut simple question diya hai. So answer zarur batana comment section. Okay. Now let's move on to the details. Okay. Covered hai? Okay. Understood. Under this national monetization pipeline, basically the government will give the brownfield projects. There is a distinction between brownfield and greenfield projects. I hope that you know that much. So brownfield projects, brownfield assets are those assets that are already developed, and greenfield projects or assets are those assets on which the work needs to be done from the very scratch. So brownfield assets will be given on lease. So these will be divided into 20 asset classes, for example, roads, railways, power, etc. And these asset classes will belong to 12 ministries, and these will be monetized. So this is the point which is stating that this asset monetization plan and infrastructure plan will work as co-terminus plan. They will work hand in hand. Okay. This national infrastructure pipeline was launched in 2019. Next is, in the monetization transaction, the government is basically transferring the revenue rights. So this I have already explained. The revenue is transferred. The revenue rights are transferred to the private entities, but not the ownership is being transferred. Okay. And do remember 6 lakh crores by FY25. Now let's have a look on technical things as well, where you need to put an extra effort. All of this is the conceptual part which you can understand and memorize, but this requires an effort from your side to memorize. Okay, this year in FY22, I hope that this is not very blur. I know that this is blur, but theek hai. FY22 mein this much is the target in trillion. In FY23, this much, FY24, this much, and FY25, this much is going to be collected by the government of India. Okay, by monetizing its asset. The government has set the target of 1.7 lakh crore. Now, this target is different from this target, because this is, again, I'm telling you, asset monetization. However, this is divestment. Here the government is doing privatization, is selling its own stake in a company and transferring the ownership as well as management rights to the private entities. So this is, we can say, privatization. this is asset monetization. Okay, so this is the target for current year. Next comes, okay, so this we are going to discuss in the next slide, but the top three sectors are road, railways and power. So let's have a look at these top three sectors. Okay, so these are the different categories, different asset classes. A total of 20 asset classes are there. However, in this pie chart, only a few asset classes are represented because these asset classes are going to have a major impact on this national monetization pipeline. Okay, so the majority is contributed by roads, 27%, railways by 25%. Then comes the power sector. So total of 15% comes from the power sector. Okay, so here this is again stating the same point that we have covered. Top three sectors would be these. Pipeline phasing. So 15% of the assets will be monetized in this year only, and this much will be gathered. Next comes the toll asset classes. So toll roads, railway stations and transmission towers. So what would be monetized in this year? Toll roads, railway stations and transmission towers would be monetized. Guys, there might be a question in your phase 2. You have in your phase 2 descriptive paper. So there might be a question on this national monetization pipeline. So again, I'm saying this thing, this is not privatization. So those who are against privatization, do keep this thing in your mind and do not write it against, do not write in opposition to this step in the examination. Okay. Even though you are talking about privatization, you are required to keep your viewpoint balanced. You are not supposed to linger on to either side, okay? Nor towards positive, nor towards negative. You need to be balanced, okay? So here we are talking about national monetization pipeline. So there are many people who are against the privatization and they are confusing it with the privatization. Therefore, I'm just keeping up this thing again and again, telling you this thing again and again, okay? Now, as far as the roads are concerned, these many kilometers of road will be privatized to collect this much amount. Now guys, this is not this year's target. This is the entire target for till FY25. Okay. Do remember. And the total contribution will be 27%. For railways, this much will be the collection and this much would be the percentage. Remember, you have to memorize these facts, okay? The facts that I am highlighting here. Power transmission, this much kilometer of grid line power transmission asset would be transferred or monetized for this much amount, and this is 8% of the share. Remember this bifurcation, power generation and power transmission. And collectively, the power sector is contributing 15%. Okay. So I hope that national monetization pipeline is clear to you now. In case you find any kind of query while covering it again, then you can just ask me in the comment section or in your Telegram group. Next comes the Global Manufacturing Risk Index, which is again a very important index. What is India's rank in the baseline scenario of Global Manufacturing Risk Index 2021? So this is released by Cushman and Wakefield organization. Bahut important index hai guys. Do listen to me carefully. So this index assesses the favorability of a country towards manufacturing, and India is having an aim to become the global manufacturing hub. And in order to give push, or we can say encouragement to that goal of Indian government, fortunately, this index, India has achieved second rank in the baseline scenario, and it has replaced US, which was earlier at the second position. Now US is at third, China is at first. Now I have written your baseline scenario. This means that this index assesses the countries on a basis of three scenarios: baseline, cost and risk scenario. But before moving on to that, you need to know that this ranking is out of 47 countries. Okay. Okay, so this is India's ranking in all the other sub-indices, we can say. So in cost sub-index, India's ranking is third. In risk sub-index, India's ranking is 28th. Parameters are the manufacturing risk index assesses the most suitable global location for locations for global manufacturing. Okay? So this is again stating the basic purpose of this index, which you can read on your own. There is nothing much here. Now let's look into the parameters of this index. So these are the parameters. Conditions refers to the baseline scenario, and these are the indicators under these three baseline, in these three scenarios, risk and cost. So baseline scenario covers these indicators, risk covers these indicators, cost covers these indicators. Okay, you just need to memorize that it has three dimensions or three scenarios in which the global manufacturing risk index gives its ranking. Apart from this, don't go into too much of its detail for phase one. Remember, this video is for phase one GK only, so don't go into too much details of it. However, if you talk about the phase two ESI also, I don't think that they will go into this much depth that they would ask you that which indicator does not fall under which category of this index. However, if you have time and strength remained in you, then you can just prepare these indicators as well. But in my opinion, that would be an extreme step if they ask you this question from this index. Okay, now comes the baseline scenario. So in baseline, the majority, the highest weightage is given to the conditions. Then conditions and cost both have the same weightage. Risk has the minimum weightage. So here China is at the top, India second, US third. Top three yaad rakhoge, chalega. Usse zyada kuch yaad mat rakho. Otherwise, sab confuse ho jaoge. In cost scenario, highest weightage is given to cost, 60%. Then risk and conditions have the same weightage, 20-20. Here India is at the third rank. China, Indonesia and India are the top three countries. Top three, teenon ki yaad rakhna. In risk scenario, weightage, highest weightage is risk, is given to risk, 60. Cost and conditions have the same weightage, 20-20. China, Canada, US are the top three. So China, you can see, is topping in all these three scenarios. This is this we can say is foreshadowing the upcoming economic scenario, we can say, in the world, because China is expected to overtake US as the world superpower by the near the end of this decade. So this is, we can say, a foreshadowing of what is going to happen in the future. However, nevertheless, India remains at the 28th position in this index. Okay. So that was all about the Global Manufacturing Risk Index released by Cushman and Wakefield. Next comes, what is the purpose of Operation Devi Shakti? So this has been launched by India in order to evacuate Indians who are stranded in Afghanistan. So option D is the right answer. So we all know what is happening in Afghanistan, and due to that, in order to evacuate Indians from there, this Operation Devi Shakti was launched. Which of the following is the partner organization of Niti Aayog in the Forum for Decarbonizing Transport? So this forum has been launched by the Niti Aayog recently. And in this forum only, this forum basically has been launched by Niti Aayog in partnership with this World Resource Institute's Indian branch. Okay, so WRI India is the partner of Niti Aayog in this forum. Now, decarbonizing transport, the name itself is suggesting the purpose of this forum. So this is going to provide a platform to different stakeholders who are involved in transportation in India so that they can work on adopting e-vehicles. Basically, they can accelerate the adoption of e-vehicles, increase the pace of adoption of e-vehicles, as well as decarbonize the transportation. Decarbonize meaning reducing the carbon emission from transportation. How can it be done? If we accelerate the adoption of e-vehicles, then decarbonization can be achieved. Now let's look into the detail of this forum. Purpose we have already discussed. India is currently engaged in building a domestic renewable automobile industry with the aim to become world's largest electric manufacturing and supplying hub. Okay, so this is the aim of India. The forum is part of the nationally determined contribution transportation initiative for Asia project. So this project was launched in 2020. We will be covering this project in detail right now only, but first let's know what this statement has to say. So this forum is part of this project which focuses on developing a coherent strategy for effective policies and formation of a multi-stakeholder platform for decarbonizing transport in the region. Which region are we talking about? Asian region. However, this project is not catering to the entire Asia. This is only limited to three countries in Asia: China, India, and Vietnam. Now let's have a look at this initiative in detail. So this was launched in 2020. Do remember this thing. It is a joint program of seven organizations that will engage China, India, and Vietnam in promoting a comprehensive approach to decarbonizing transport in their own countries. This is part of the International Climate Initiative, and the project was launched in 2020. And this is the name, this is the list of the names of organizations that have launched this program. Okay, so that is all to this program. I hope that you have understood it well. Moving on to the last question. So with which country did Philippines conduct maritime partnership exercise in the West Philippine Sea? So you see that different countries conduct military exercises, maritime exercises, army, air force exercises. However, you only tend to focus on the exercises that are conducted by India. But guys, the exercises that other countries conduct are also important. So I hope that this might have confused you so far. The right answer to this question is India only. All what I have said is just to confuse you. However, there was truth in it. You need to focus on other exercises as well that are conducted by different countries. As far as this exercise is concerned, India and Philippines have conducted this exercise in Philippine Sea. That's all about this question. Thank you so much guys for watching the session. Do watch these sessions as well as the other videos that we provide you. Thank you so much for watching the session.